Inflammation is fundamentally a protective response of the body against any offending agent or tissue damage. It involves responses of the vascular tissues and leukocytes, which help in getting rid of the primary cause of insult, and necrotic cells or tissues resulting as a consequence of the insult. Inflammation could be acute or chronic, depending on the duration of the response. Acute inflammation is a rapid response developing within minutes and could last up to a few hours to a few days. But if the insult or damage is not repaired by the acute response, the inflammatory response could become prolonged, thus becoming chronic. Chronic inflammation could go on for a few weeks to many months. So inflammation could be caused by multiple factors ranging from external agents like microbes, drugs, and allergens, physical agents like temperature or any form of mechanical injury, and other factors like genetic and immunologic disorders. Tissue necrosis due to ischemia, mechanical or chemical injury could also induce inflammation. So there are five cardinal signs of inflammation, which actually are a macro level or an external manifestation of the microscopic events happening during inflammation. So inflammation kickstarts with vasodilation of arterioles and capillaries near the site of tissue insult, and this leads to rubor or redness. Vasodilation results in an increased blood flow, causing calor or heat. Leakage of plasma fluids from the vessels and accumulation of these fluids in the extravascular space causes tumor or swelling. Chemical mediators of inflammation like histamine and prostaglandins may cause dolor or pain. And finally, swelling and pain may cause a loss of function of the tissue involved and is called functio lysa, or a loss of function. An inflammatory response begins with an insult, which could be exogenous or endogenous. Now, any form of insult causes cell damage, and damaged cells release certain molecules called damage-associated molecular patterns. These molecules are recognized by receptors on the leukocytes like macrophages or dendritic cells. And on recognition, leukocytes release pro-inflammatory cytokines. Similarly, microbes have specific molecules called pathogen-associated molecular patterns, which could be recognized by receptors on leukocytes. And on recognition, leukocytes release pro-inflammatory cytokines and also other cytokines that help lymphocyte activation. Now, pro-inflammatory cytokines could cause degranulation of the nearby mast cells, and degranulation results in release of inflammatory mediators like histamine, eicosanoids like prostaglandins and leukotrienes, and even more pro-inflammatory cytokines. This cascade of events kickstarts an acute inflammatory response. Acute inflammation begins with vasodilation of arterioles and capillaries. Vasodilation could be caused by histamine, leukotrienes, and prostaglandins. This is followed by an increased vascular permeability. So histamine and leukotrienes can cause retraction of endothelial cells, creating small gaps in the vessel walls. And plasma proteins leak out of the blood vessel through these gaps and accumulate in the extravascular space, causing edema. This plasma-rich fluid leaking out of the vessel and accumulating in the extravascular space is called an exudate. Leakage of plasma proteins disturbs the axial flow of blood, and it increases blood viscosity, thereby slowing down or causing stasis of blood flow. This results in red blood cells getting concentrated at the center, with leukocytes being pushed to the periphery near the vessel wall. So acute inflammation basically serves to recruit leukocytes to the site of infection or injury in order to eliminate the offending agents and damaged tissue. Neutrophils and monocytes are key leukocytes that are recruited and are capable of phagocytosis. However, in acute inflammation, neutrophils are the first batch of leukocytes to be recruited to the site of infection. Migration of monocytes follows many hours later. So leukocyte recruitment to the site of infection involves a series of steps. Once the blood flow slows down, leukocytes are pushed to the periphery and move along in close association to the endothelium. And this process is called margination. Pro-inflammatory cytokines like interleukin-1 and tumor necrosis factor alpha, released by macrophages and mast cells, cause endothelial cells and leukocytes to express what are called adhesion molecules. Now, adhesion molecules on the endothelium are called selectins, and those that are expressed on the leukocytes are called silyl Lewis proteins. So these silyl Lewis proteins bind with selectins, causing leukocytes to slow down and tumble along the endothelium, a process called rolling. So rolling and slowing down basically helps leukocytes firmly adhere to the endothelium. This adherence is accomplished by binding of certain surface proteins on leukocytes called integrins to adhesion molecules on the endothelium called VCAMP or vascular cell adhesion molecules. Expression of vascular cell adhesion molecules on the endothelium are induced by pro-inflammatory cytokines like interleukin-1 and tumor necrosis factor alpha. The next step involves transmigration of adherent leukocytes through the endothelial gaps to the extravascular space. And this process, called diapedesis, is induced by chemokines. Once in the extravascular space, leukocytes migrate towards the site of infection along a concentration gradient, a process called chemotaxis. Chemotaxis is induced by a variety of chemokines produced by mast cells, complement proteins, and the microbes themselves. Examples of chemokines are interleukin-8, leukotriene B4, and complement proteins like C5a. Neutrophils predominate in the site of infection for the first 6 to 24 hours, followed by monocytes getting into action post 24 to 48 hours. And after recruitment to the site of infection, leukocytes recognize microbes or dead cells and kill them by a process called phagocytosis.